What's going on, everybody out there? I'm Chris, he's Mike, and you are back with us again for another Dark Avenger comic book review. A bit late, and that's due to the holiday seasons. But before we get into any of the books that we are about to talk about that came out the week of...
December...
14th?
I think 14th, let me check. Let's see.
14th?
Yeah, December 14th.
2016. There you go. But before we get into any of that, first and foremost, we hope you guys have a wonderful, happy, happy holiday. That is the most important thing that we want to make sure that we say before we get into any comic books, before we get into anything comic related. We're doing this live. We did not do Dark Avenger live today because we were super busy. It is 2:00 in the morning, Eastern Standard Time. I see we have two viewers. Wow. I was not expecting anybody to be watching us live. But anyway, this is the holiday season. The wonderful thing is Hanukkah starts today, or started today, which is December 24th. Christmas is tomorrow, December 25th. And then on Monday, the 26th, is Kwanzaa. So we have wonderful, wonderful holidays. Oh, MT, what's going on, man? MT's on the live show. So if you see us answering comments, that's why. And Middle J's up. Man, what's up, guys? And Jeremy Renfro, what's up, man? Oh, wow. We got lots of really awesome people that are up late. Nice. So what we're going to do is we're going to do our comic review live. And hopefully all of you are having a wonderful, happy, happy holiday, or will have a wonderful, happy holiday. All you guys in the comments as well, hopefully you guys are having a very happy holiday or getting ready for a happy holiday. So we figured we'd do this live once again. And we have a lot of books. And here's what we're going to do. These books came out not this past Wednesday, but last Wednesday. And because there's a lot, there's a reason I'm explaining. Because there's a lot, and because we've already kind of talked about a lot of it on Frontline Live this past Tuesday, we're going to kind of graze through all of our books. We will answer comments since we are doing this live. If we see any comments about anything we're talking about, we will absolutely answer comments as we move along. I'm actually going to make sure the camera sticks closed. I'm going to bring the comments up so I can see them. I know that you're on camera now, so it doesn't matter if the comments, but I will actually shrink the comments just a wee bit more because I don't think comments will get that big, and then you're all there, so you're fine.
Yeah.
So, okay, let's get into books, and we're starting with Mighty Morphin Power Rangers Pink, issue number 4?
Oh, 5.
5. 5 of 6, the penultimate issue. I really enjoyed this issue. I like this take on Kimberly. I like the writing that's in this story. I like the pacing. Goldar, that twist at the end, who's up here? Rebel, what's going on, man? First time I've seen Rebel Comics and Gaming in the comments. So what's going on, man? So I enjoyed the issue a lot. You know, I read it because I'm a Power Ranger fan. I'll get to comments after this in a moment. I saw 5 volumes of Invincible at second, and Charlie's gonna get check. Nice. So I really enjoyed the issue. I think the twist with Goldar at the end where, he's like, we worked with the Pink Ranger. They defeated the person they were up against. I keep forgetting the villain's name. And then Goldar kind of does that villain twist at the end. I like that. I like that a lot. And now the Power Rangers are in trouble, but Zordon can't help them. So Kimberly is going to take her makeshift Rangers, Zach, Trini, and the other two that are, temporary Rangers, up to space to help the other Power Rangers. The twist with Zach and Trini, though, I gotta say, I always thought Trini would be with Billy. Kind of a bit of a twist there, but it kind of does make sense because of what happens with Billy.
Yep.
Staying on the alien planet in the end. What's going on, Jesse Johnson? Man, everybody, people staying up late.
Well, it's Christmas Eve.
All right.
It's the season.
Reborn issue number 3. Okay, I want to make sure it was 3 and not 4. I like this issue because you've got the main character. She's looking for her husband who passed away, and there's a funny stint on fairies, and we find out that dragons are getting, they're used to grazing a specific place, and now they're grazing in other places. They're getting bolder. Things are getting dangerous. They get captured by this group of people who are chasing after them from, the villain that wants to take them in, or the guy that's searching for them. He's the cat that had his... I got fixed that hates her for it.
I have no idea. I never read the book.
I know, but it's hilarious. That part's hilarious, at least. And I'm really digging it, though. I love... oh, my God. His name left me for the moment. There it is. Greg Capello's artwork. I don't know why I had Capello. His first name left me. I love Greg Capello's artwork. The cat wants revenge. I know he wants revenge. He wants revenge for the snip snip. And that was that was funny for me. I mean, she spayed me. Now I want my revenge. And we get a glimpse of her powers, actually, in this issue. We find out that she kind of has they're starting to manifest a little bit. They try to escape, actually, captivity. And they do, but then they get tricked, and they end up getting sent to the mountains, the darkness mountains or whatever, and they end up being trapped there. And it's really, really awesome stuff. I love the world building in Reborn. I absolutely do love. I love the afterlife world rebuilding that they're doing. It's really cool, and death still happens in this other world as well. You can die.
I see.
Check out Comic Island soon project I am working on with them. Be out, and I'm excited to share. Oh, that's cool, Jeremy. Great. I can't wait to hear about the project. But let's move forward. I think that was it for me digitally. Yeah, we're going into Michael's books now.
Yep. Insufferable Home Field Advantage, issue number 3. I believe this is volume 3.
It is volume 3.
Okay, of Insufferable.
There was Insufferable Road Trip, and now there's this.
And now there's this one, yeah. So in this one, I keep forgetting that guy's name. Like, there's Galahad and the other guy.
Nocturnus.
Thank you.
See, I remember their names, but I can't remember names in my books.
No, but I'm just saying. It starts off where Nocturnus is going to save... what was her name? I had a name.
There's this thing with comics, and it's called, we can't remember the names, we just remember the characters.
I think it was, Meg, that was her name. He's trying to go and save Meg from this abandoned building with the security guards, and he gets there. He uses a stunt double, actually, to, you know, go in disguise, and he goes as himself. Mm-hmm. While Galahad, on the other hand, spoiler for this, not really much.
It's a spoiler, keep going.
Bob does... it looks like that he dies in this because he's fixing the whole thing of whatnot that's been going on. So he gets killed and all that. And Galahad feels really bad about it. And he's trying to help the poor guy. And everyone's saying, well, you're hated. We don't like you because you've done this.
There are a couple of haters.
There are a couple of haters indeed.
Couple of haters.
And, you know, and Galahad's been treated really bad. And he gets... arrest, but then he flees and everything, and then he goes to the news saying, you know, Bob, I would say this though as a joke, you're an idiot, because he's actually saved the city from what's been going on. But a really great issue, guys. I'll definitely say pick that up.
Mark Miller said he wants to make a Reborn film. Who would you choose to play the main characters? I'm not really good with the actors and actresses, but I think it's really great if they do make it a movie. I think it definitely has movie quality. Just should check out this comic I found by Mark Miller called Super Crooks. That's a good book. I do remember reading a free comic book day version of it. Villains Robbing Villains.
All right.
Now you talked about that on the live show.
And this is actually a 25 cents book, as some fell over there.
Off the wall.
Red Sonja issue number 0. This one I could sum up in like a couple sentences, because this took me less than 5 minutes to read, because this is actually a prelude that will lead into issue number 1. And basically it's like Red Sonja, she fights off against this person that could, turn time forward, because she is a Viking, Red Sonja, as the book is.
Couple of Vikings.
Well, that's why there was a team between Red Sonja and Conan. And you said that she actually teamed up with Spider-Man at one time. So she gets sent into the present time, which is now. And then she's like saying, you know, like, where have I been sent to? I'm not familiar with this. I'm not familiar with that. So, you know, she's kind of like not used to these things that we see nowadays. And then when she comes out of the sewer into the city, the policemen are surrounding her, saying, we have you surrounded under arrest and all that stuff. So for her to just see what's this, what's that, and everything, not take a Nightmare Before Christmas as a pun there, that's going to be actually good to see in the issues on the ongoing series.
Finally, the ending issue of issue 4, Britannia, issue number 4 from Valiant. And this comic book actually, unlike the other issues, this was actually pretty good, where Roman actually goes on the quest to fight off against the demons, and he actually finds the things he was looking for in Britannia.
There was like Merry Christmas to everyone from your favorite moderator. What's going on, Alan? What's going on, man? Yeah. I knew he'd be happy. He's on when I mentioned we were doing a live show, because we didn't do Dark Avenger live. We're doing Dark Avenger comic book review instead.
Uh-huh. But yeah, but long story short, though, he was just fighting off against these demons and stuff like that. But now, at the end of the issue, though, it talked about how his son died and something like that. Like, we get a little bit into his character, so it might maybe go into Volume 2. I'm really not too sure about that. But it was a good issue nonetheless. I wish the other issues were, you know, a little, you know. But it was long dialogue, though. Wrath of the Eternal Warrior, issue number 14, which is the also ending issue of this one. So two Valiant books that had an ending issue.
Oh, don't worry. I'm sure they'll both
be. Oh, yeah. Wrath of the Eternal Warrior, of course. Yeah. But this is where the Eternal Warrior and his son, Kalim, I think that's how you say Kalim, whatever. They fight their way through hell. So that way he saves his son to bring him back. And you know what I loved about this issue that was really powerful? That his son actually, who taught him to be strong, that he helped his son. When his father was down and weak, he helped his father. That was the I can't express how emotional that book was, that he actually helped him. And he didn't really get along with his father because he's been away, you know, from his family. So that's why they never got eye to eye to each other. But all in all, though, guys, they got back to Earth. Everything is fine, and he's back with his family. And of course, he's still the Eternal Warrior, as the issue says. So really great issue. I definitely recommend trade paperback for that.
I got the Claws one shot that came out Wednesday. No spoilers. I just want to say Grant Morrison is not done with Santa Claus. He could probably do. I'm sure he is going to do it as a yearly thing. I haven't read any books that came out this past Wednesday yet. I will be probably doing it starting Monday. Again, next week's review is probably going to be late, A, because this weekend is Christmas.
Yeah, along with the comic review,
and, I was going to say. And not to mention next weekend's New Year's and New Year's Eve. So we're going to try our best, but I think the next two comic reviews are going to be late because holidays. It's just, this is, December is the hardest time of the year, I'd like to think, for reviews.
Well, at the end.
Yes, towards the end of December. So that's why things are a little late. Thank God we don't have any anniversaries, like hundreds around December.
Well, yeah.
It'll get there eventually. Alan, it was hell yesterday, lost trying to get to the mall. Oh, you know, Alan, you know what I heard? I heard your mom and dad say they were going to start a new tradition of waiting until Christmas morning before you could open your presents. So you're going to have to wait an extra 24 hours, my man. That's what your dad said. How's your son? My son is doing really good. He is asleep right now, enjoying. He is going to have a very Merry Christmas. The boxes you guys see over there, well, minus the two Pokemon boxes and obviously the Coca-Cola box. Yeah, that's all stuff that I have to wrap. That's for him, for people. He's going to have a very good Christmas this year. Plus, we got him a nice big car. So it's going to be fun watching him walk around the house in the car until it gets warm out again. That's like when we got, remember when we got bikes for Christmas?
Yep.
And it was like, we can't even touch them for freaking 3 months.
And the Batmobile.
The Batmobile I was allowed to sit in at least
when
I was a kid.
Yeah, you broke it.
I didn't break it. I let kids sit in it and they broke it.
Mom kept saying you broke it.
Because I let people sit in it.
Well, she never said that part.
No, of course she didn't.
Yeah, they had detail.
These all don't right, have so, a bounty on me. Oh, you do. Alan, you do. It's for me. It's worse than Eagles.
Can I please?
Watch yourself when you're on a game. And we got Larry Lawn. What's up, man? Merry Christmas, man. Merry Christmas, Larry.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. It's great having you on here. Man, eight of you. Eight of you don't like to sleep or you guys are on like the West Coast because what time? 12, 2, 1, 12, 11, about 11, 10, 11 o'clock. Yeah, it makes sense. 10, 11 o'clock, but still not late yet in the West Coast. A lot of you guys are probably from the West Coast or at least Central. Hey, guys, I heard there was a comic tie-in with the film Krampus. You guys, no, never heard of it. I just bought my cousin a PS3 for $80. Wow.
Oh, I heard of Krampus. That's a, I think, a horror movie or something. Because that's in Xenoscope,
that term, Krampus.
And an army card? That's going to be interesting, yeah. Alan. All right, so let's get back to the books.
Speaking of Zenoscope, actually.
Yeah, we got to get moving with the books, too. I mean, it is a live show, but we still got to do it.
Okay, so...
It's 11:20. Okay, it's 11:30 there.
I thought you were going to say it's beginning till the
middle. Middle J's in Cali, so Middle J says it's 11:30. Oh, dude.
What?
Darth Vader.
21.
Dude, we got everybody. We got Darth Vader in the house. Holy dude. We do a late comic review, and we got Darth Vader.
Wow.
The dark side has entered. The Dark Avenger comic book review. What's going on, Dark Avenger 21? Happy holidays, man.
You said Dark Avenger 21. It's Darth Vader.
Don't buy it. I know, Larry. Don't worry. We're probably not. But I got to admit, DCBS does really wonderful sales, so we might still get it because we will not be paying that price tag. If we were, I wouldn't. But I don't. Well, we probably won't be paying near that price tag. Go ahead, Mike. Mike wants to go. We're going to go.
Let's I want to go. Thanks.
Let's go.
Van Helsing versus Frankenstein, issue number 4 or 5. One last issue.
If you'd like to do comments, guys, Dark Avenger Live, I'm going to try my hardest to get it out next Friday. I promise. So come back. Everybody who's new here, come back. We do it 9:35 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Friday. So anybody here, please come back at 9:35 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and we will be able to talk more comments.
Yes. So... In Van Helsing versus Frankenstein, you know, Frankenstein has been getting a lot stronger as his more robotic form, I would say. And his girlfriend, I can't remember her name for life of me. I think it's
she's
Jessica.
A cup of haters.
Well, yeah, I
guess.
She's
a cup of haters.
Well, she is trying to get through Frank's mind because, you know, they're together and everything. And he calms down a little bit. But when it's between her and Van Helsing, I tell you, the two, they clash. Like, they cause chaotic throughout the whole city.
Chaos.
But in the end, though...
In the end, there can be only one.
No. In the end, though, when she actually goes to where Frank is, because she has, like, this tracker and stuff like that, they're in this place where I don't think that she is welcome towards, because those creatures there, those are a couple of haters. To be continued the next issue.
By the way, speaking of there can be only one, while Michael transitions to his next... Well, no, yeah, you're going to transition there. Anybody who's looking forward to Highlander, we have to sit down. We only have a week left before we can make our order for DCBS in February.
Okay, yeah,
so it's coming out in February, guys. Who's excited for Highlander? Hashtag Highlander hype in the comments if you're excited. Been marathoning Final Fantasy 15. Love worth 8+ years of waiting. Eventually, I'll get that game.
Okay. Now, this book, he thought I should try out since my YouTube
name... Oh, you thought so, too.
Since my YouTube name is Dudorock18.
Cup of haters.
The issue number one from Image I want to try out was Rockstars, issue number one. And I just want to tell you this. This is the worst book of the week. This book, from Frontline Live, from what they said also...
He's a cup
of haters. ...did not get through this book. Now, I got through this book.
You did.
And there are some things that I did not like about the book. Number one, the artwork was, like, seriously.
I
understand,
think the artwork is psychedelic for a reason.
I understand that, you know, this is taking place in the 1970s or something like that. And it's rock and roll and da-da-da-da and all that stuff. The storyline, however, was kind of a little creepy. I mean, the point of the
story... Darth Vader agrees, the worst.
Yeah, I mean... Ooh, had a little bit there. The story is that a what if Paul McCarthy died, but they don't use his name Paul McCarthy. They just use it to symbolize that, it, you know, because it's a copyrighted name. So they use something else. And then it's just like a whole spiel of this girl trying to look for this other girl. And then the news press is asking this boy a question where they're going into this place. And then there's these weird faces that are like, I mean, look at this. Like, here's one side of the page that looks like this. And the other side of the page is different, but has those little creepy things. And there is a bit of nudity as well. So this is an adult book. But the worst book. I don't even really know if I'm going to come for issue 2.
You're
but
not
if
coming
I see,
back for issue 2.
Yeah, no. I just couldn't with this issue. So, you know, I know about rock and roll and everything. And rock on with my Dude Rock 18 name. But the book of that is no, actually. Now, this one I review for Comic Frontline. Sonic Universe, issue number 93, The Case of the Pirate Princess, part 3 or 4.
So you shouldn't have that much to say about it.
Yeah, it's basically Team Chaotix on a pirate adventure of going on this island where the captain wants to find his treasure. The princess...
It definitely is, Darth Vader. You said about Rockstar looking like crap.
The princess was decoding this... you know how they have like these different symbols and the person can read it? So it said that there was a destructive untold power and everything, and she said that's a warning, we should turn back. And of course the captain's saying, oh no, we should go forward behind the vault. We don't know what's going to go on after that, because that's where it's left off after that. So they're not welcome there, because there's also someone that jumped somebody from the boat that was watching in case, you know, they should steal or whatnot. Good idea, though, but bad idea, because lots of mystical stuff happens.
It's time for another. Good idea, bad idea.
Yeah, good idea, bad idea, right?
Larry, I'm only getting Amazing Spider-Man for a while. We'll get to Spider-Man in a moment, Larry.
All right, Cinderella, Serial Killer Princess, issue number one. This is more like a what-if story if Cinderella was the strongest person that killed almost everybody. It is, seriously. And her objective is to kill Robin Hood. Because in the past, we know that Cinderella fought Robin Hood, and Robin Hood beat the holy snot out of her, like, hands down, when they had a clash with each other. So she's going after every Zenoscope character that's in this book, and she also kills Marion and Sam together. And she sends a powerful message: Robin, you're next. I hope when she meets up with Robin, I hope that Robin just gets an arrow and just gets her one. But it's a Cinderella story, it's probably not going to go down that way. No. It's probably going to be just Cinderella everything. Dream of a wish her heart makes, right?
No.
All right.
DN, dude, now you, I know, are on the East Coast. It is 2:30 in the morning, dude. Another one that's up late. Been enjoying Grace and Nightwing title. I've been loving Nightwing. Wow, Cinderella is here. Darth Vader, Zenoscope takes a lot of the open property characters and they put a spin on it in their universe.
Yeah,
it's
like
really cool.
They do with Red Agent and Robin Hood, I Love NYC. And all the other books.
It's really good. I would definitely recommend checking out Zenoscope. They make great,
and Patrick
awesome
Shan
stuff.
Writes some of them, actually.
Yeah, he does. And he's a good friend of ours. He actually just got his Kickstarter. His book was successfully funded on Kickstarter. We can't wait to get our thing in the mail. It's not a sick joke, but it has mature content. Don't the price... really bad, only get if you are diehard fan of Marvel. Oh, you're talking about Spider-Man.
All right, Street Fighter Unlimited Annual issue number one, and this one just has a bunch of stories in this book. I think there's like five stories, and I think from what the Street Fighter says, I really should show some artwork actually, you know. It's just like them, like one part is just Chun-Li, I believe, fighting through a tournament. And then there's like the artwork in this book, though, is like drawn really nicely. Like definitely like Street Fighter. And then we get Jury in this book, who checks out a secret organization agency. And we get Charlie, who is being more of a wimp as always, talking with Sakura. I couldn't remember her name, but I remember now. Sakura. And his embarrassing thing, because Danny's always an embarrassing character.
There was a variant with Dan in front. See, that's what I'm looking forward to.
Yeah, this
year.
One, yeah. This one I'm definitely going to get in the mail, as well as review it right here on Comic Frontline. That is going to be something that I'm definitely going to be looking forward to reading and seeing about that. I actually read Street Fighter versus G.I. Joe, so Darkstalkers, why not?
I love Darkstalkers. Plus, you got Marvel versus Capcom
Infinite.
Yeah, I'm
not reading that. And yet, wait, what do you mean? Oh, the game. Yeah, the game. I thought you weren't that interested in the game.
I don't do fighting games, but I love Marvel versus Capcom. That pays homage a lot to our arcading. I know.
Of that.
Now, Vision was a good comic. I don't read Vision, Jeremy. I'm sorry, man. But my comic of the week has to go to TMNT, issue number 65. This was a wonderful holiday issue where the Turtles are throwing a party, and the first part of the issue is the Turtles inviting people and people finding out about the party, like the The Mutanimals find out about the party. They try to invite Harold. He ignores them. Chet shows up. Angel shows up. They invite Casey, but not with the dragons. Slash finds out, and he shows up. And it's just a wonderful holiday party. It is just a wonderful. And Bishop actually, unfortunately, is in a scene where he's trying to find the turtles. And it's just a very wonderful, awesome holiday book. A nice reprieve from what just happened.
Yeah, the turtles always do that every year, I think, the Christmas-like book.
It's a wonderful reprieve from what just happened. And then we do get Splinter in the end. So there's still some hope for Splinter. I don't think Splinter's going towards the dark side yet, everybody. We'll have to wait and see. But this book...
No,
definitely.
I can't do that to Splinter. No,
this book definitely. Go out. You don't need to know what's going on to get a holiday issue. This is the Kevin Eastman variant. This book was the best of the week.
Yeah, I mean, it did already with Leonardo. I think after that, we had enough. And the death of Donatello that got resurrected.
Oh, Larry, you are not alone, man. I don't either. Did I miss all of the DC stuff? No. We haven't even touched DC yet, DN. We are going into Marvel right now, which Mike has two, and then I have one physical, and then it's all DC, man. So you're good. You didn't miss any DC yet. All
right, so let's start off with Silk, issue number 15. Now, this issue, or Silkworm, I should say, is her name. I still don't agree with the name, but whatever. She fight, and this is a clone conspiracy time, by the way. She fights off against Spider-Woman. And they have, like, this long conversation about each other and their stories and everything. I mean, I kind of found it a little bit boring. Like not, like, the worst. Like, I just found it a little bit boring because they were just going into these, this whole thing about Black Cat still, about, you know, what's going on with her. And then J. Jonah Jameson's really caring to Silk, you know, with everything that's been going on, you know.
And I agree, Jeremy. DC is definitely ending 2016 on a really good note.
Yeah, but...
Marvel needs a lot of work.
Yeah. But this issue was a little bit okay. I definitely say pick this up, Marine Silk, all along. And this one I did review for Comic Frontline. Also, Power Man and Iron Fist, issue number 11, the dynamic duo, which I call them. It's not really said in the book. I just call them that. And in this book, it's just basically talking about the Fang Gang, about them trying to take over the Lowell Empire. And they do manage to do that when one of the new gang goes there and then takes it over. Whereas Power Man and Iron Fist, they're doing their own thing about helping people and finding out about that Agnetus. It's the facial recognition thing. We find out more about that, actually. And I have a funny feeling that's going to play a huge role in the Power Man and the Iron Fist comic series.
Yeah, we'll talk about that, yeah.
But... yeah, but if you want to find out more of what I said, you can check out my review right here on Comic Frontline, actually. But I really enjoyed the book. I mean, it was an average read of that much, but I'd say check it out.
And while we're at Marvel, and Marvel owns Star Wars, I want to put out our thoughts and prayers to Carrie Fisher, who had a heart attack today and is in the hospital in critical condition. Oh. And hopefully 2016, you know, will not claim Carrie Fisher and she'll get better. We send all of our well wishes. We hope that she pulls through. I'm sure by now she's stable, I'm hoping. But everybody's sitting at the edge of their seats waiting to hear the news about Carrie Fisher. And we're all worried here on Frontline. And I'm especially worried because Carrie Fisher, I love Carrie Fisher. Yeah. And we send our hopes and prayers to her family. And we hope and pray that we hear some good news soon. Hopefully we'll hear Christmas Miracle and she's okay. And everybody's saying, hope you get better, Carrie. We love you, Carrie, 2016. Yeah, right? I agree, Alan. I won't say it out loud, but I agree. 2016 won't stop. Well, no, 2016 has been a horrible year. But let's go back to the books now. But Carrie Fisher, please get better soon. We are in our hopes and in our prayers right now. Amazing Spider-Man Renew Your Vows, issue number 2, or we should just say Mary Jane's point of view, because that's what we get. We get a little bit in the present, and then we go back in time, and we get to see Mary Jane's day. We find out that her suit, if she's using her suit and Pete's using his powers at the same time, it severely drains Pete. So now they have to figure out a norm for how Mary Jane and Pete are going to both be superheroes or work together. I'm sure that Pete will figure something out at some point. And then we go back to the present where it's the Mole Men versus Spider-Man, Mary Jane, and their daughter, who shows up, gets grounded, and then, well, we all know she was grounded from the last issue because she shouldn't have been there. And then she ends up sticking around anyway and getting carted away by the mole people. And then something happens with Spider-Man and Mary Jane. Mary Jane wakes up in front of Mole Man, and we get the name Spinneret.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only downside is Spinneret. But she's pissed off, and it looks like Mole Man's in a lot of trouble. Renew your vows. Renew your vows, man. I love Renew Your Vows. I love it. I think it's great. Amazing Spider-Man does have Clone Conspiracy. Larry, you hate Clone Conspiracy. I'm okay with it right now. Beware of the Mighty Spinneret, right? I'm okay with it right now. I like Clone Conspiracy because we might be getting Ben Reilly back. Mm-hmm. However, if at some point Marvel made us vote for which Spider-Man we want in the main Marvel universe, hands down, it's going to the one with Spinneret. I'm sorry. But, I mean, Superman has a son now. Spider-Man can have a daughter in the main Marvel universe. I want the Spider-Man with Mary Jane back in the original Marvel universe. I think that would be great. Is it me or is Marvel doing great when they're not focusing on main characters or just letting their teen hero do whatever? Marvel does great when they're not focusing on events. When they're not focusing on events and when they aren't trying to destroy franchises like the X-Men because of movies. Oh, you don't like because Ben... I don't know if Ben Reilly's a bad guy, though, Larry. We're still kind of unclear. If he is, though, I'm not going to be too happy whatsoever. But that is true. He did bring back a lot of supervillains, so I'm going to have to wait and see. Batman Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, issue number 2. We get the backstory on how Joker and Harley ended up in the Turtles universe. Batman and the Turtles meet, finally. And, of course, we get the almighty fight between Batman, I believe it's Dick Robin, Batgirl, the Turtles, and April. And, of course, they fight first, then they realize they're on the same side, and then they team up. However, the book ends right with Poison Ivy showing up. To be continued. So they did fight for a little while, but this is a quick resolve. It was a very quick resolve. It was a couple of pages, and then we go right into the team up again. If you're a fan of the animated series, Batman the Animated Series, if you're a fan of the Nickelodeon Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, you will like this book. I think the story is still very decent, but it's not like the comic book crossover that happened a couple of months back. I feel like Marvel is juggling too much at once. They need to back up a little bit. I found because my brother worked for Marvel. He is the Jackal. Dude, your brother works for Marvel? Tell your brother he needs to fix a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff, Larry. Please. We need it fixed. Ben in Iron Man series, just random for him wanting to fight Doom. Plus, was the deal with Doom not being depowered since last day of Man? I don't know, Jeremy. I don't know, man. All right, now Michael has a book.
Yes, and this was also a review on Comic Frontline. I had a lot of books I review on Comic Frontline. Deathstroke issue number 8, the showdown between...
I think you only have one more book, if I'm not mistaken.
I believe so, which I didn't review for Frontline. But Deathstroke issue number 8, the showdown between Deathstroke and Superman. Now, I got to just show the artwork, how they drew Superman and Deathstroke in this issue.
Oh, before you go into DC, because we were just in Marvel and I forgot. Yes. I just want to throw out there, I did read or begin to read... Hawkeye issue 1. I didn't finish it. It looks interesting. That's going to be more of my casual read. And from DC, Gotham Academy has moved to my casual read as well. I'm in the middle of that book right now too, but it is good. So I would definitely recommend Hawkeye and Gotham Academy. It's just not going to be in this review, but I have read both. I am in the middle of reading both books. Sorry, go.
So yeah, so the plot of this book is that Superman is trying to stop Deathstroke from killing Al Santi because Deathstroke's mission is to kill him. And we all know that Superman, doesn't want to, because he doesn't believe in anybody killing anyone. So Deathstroke, he actually does successfully do that, but then instead of...
And God bless your brother, Larry. He said his brother's trying to fix Marvel. God bless your brother, Larry. Send him our best. Send him my best, because at least he's trying and he's working. So,
and Deathstroke, knowing that Superman won't kill him or have anything to say about it, his son Jericho does as well. So then he just knocks him out conscious. So I really thought that the fight, you know, between...
Deion's comments are for you when you're done. Deion's comments are for you.
Yeah, but I really think that the fight of Superman was a fair, great fight. I mean, Batman's fight with Deathstroke was okay, and Superman was great as well. And we don't know if he might encounter with another person, probably maybe Wonder Woman or anyone else, because, you know, it's Batman, Superman, Wonder Woman.
And before Mike gets to Deion's comments, I agree, Jeremy. Raven is a very good miniseries. And Larry, once again, tell your brother, you know, I don't mean no insult to Marvel. I want Marvel to be great, and that's why I poke at them a lot. I poked at DC for 5 years. Rebirth.
I remember.
And I'm very happy with DC. All Marvel has to do is straighten up a little bit, and I'll be happy with Marvel again, too. Now you have two comments from DC.
I love how hard Slade abused Clark. That opening speech is amazing. Where were you, Superman? Where were you? Yeah. He actually really, emotionally gets to Superman and everything. Like, with all this stuff that's been going on and everything, like, he really gets to him, Deathstroke. So he's like a real, like, you know, something else with Superman and everything, like knowing the story about what he's been through and all that stuff. I mean, you know him more because you've been reading. I'm surprised you didn't read that, because that's Superman.
All right, we are in the month of December, and with the month of December, we did say starting next year, we're going to start dropping books. Batgirl and the Birds of Prey, issue number 5, is going to be my first one. I thought the issue was okay. It was kind of a little bit of a letdown. You know, we were all guessing who the Oracle was, and then it turns out it's just this big fanboy of Barbara, and it turns out he just wants to become part of the Birds of Prey. So really, he's doing all this Oracle stuff for profit, but he wants to work for Barbara. He wants to work with the Birds of Prey. That's what he wants, and we get his backstory. We find out that he went around as Oracle for a bit. He decided to become an Oracle when he heard about what was going on with Barbara, that she came back as Batgirl. We get this awesome scene right here where Barbara does the three phases. I am Oracle, I am Barbara Gordon, and I am Batgirl. I'm all damn three, and that's true. But she gives the guy a chance, and now the Birds of Prey chase after Fenice. And we find out, spoiler alert here, that Fenice is Huntress's mother.
Oh,
interesting twist. But again, these are characters that I don't really dig. This is a book that I normally don't read, and obviously we got all the first issues or all the first story arcs to test out and see if we would. And honestly, Mike, you're the Batgirl fan. I mean, you really are enjoying Batgirl. Maybe you would like this more than me.
I'm seeing this review, I don't think I'm gonna but give it a try.
I don't know, but I know that you read two out of the three girls that are in this book: Green Arrow, Batgirl,
Black Canary. And
yeah.
Batgirl.
Well, if you want the new story arc
right now,
Oracle part was bad, but you might like it for the characters. The new story arc is coming out, or the continuation of what's happening here, where Fenice is revealed as Huntress's mom, is starting in the next issue. We are going digital with Batgirl and the Birds of Prey. The question is if Mike's going to do it, or we're just going to drop it, because this book is not for me. It's just not.
Well, I really wasn't.
Have you guys heard about the rumors of the new Batman game with Damon? I've heard rumors, man. I don't know. And Jeremy, the only way for me to explain it is New 52. I don't know if you guys read New Superman last week, but that was the Superman book of the week. Extra Father Son Feels. New Superman, issue number 6. And yes, there were father-son feels in this book. You had Kenan, who was doing nothing but trying his best to save his friends, to save the people. The father was there to back him up. It was an awesome fight. It was a really good, what do you call it, back and forth. Kenan was in trouble. The father stepped in. There were some really big feels with the father, I will say that. But in the end, the Justice League of China was triumphant, and we get this big twist at the end. It turns out that Dr. Omen might be Kenan's mom.
Are you serious?
This book, however, We'll be moving from a physical to a digital format starting next month. So I will not be holding physical copies anymore, but I will still be discussing New Superman. I'm now interested in seeing where the next issue goes. I was going to drop it, but now I'm going to stick around and see what happens next. My brother works with Amazing Spider-Man writer Dan Slott, and he, but a great artist. Oh, Eminem? Stuart Eminem? Oh, man, of course, I like Stuart Eminem's art, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. I like Eminem a little bit, I believe. I have to see the artwork. He looks Italian. She does look Italian, I will admit that. Wonder Woman, been interesting. We'll get into that. You guys ever read Justice League Beyond comics? I reviewed them all, MT. Reviewed them all. I enjoyed it. It's because of Superman Beyond, but still. But, yeah, I'm going to stick with New Superman digitally and see what happens. Suicide Squad issue number 8. Harley Quinn Sane is able to take down Zod, and for some reason Hack has the ability to go into Zod, connect him to the computer somehow, and out of Zod pops Boomerang. Captain Boomerang's alive again. So apparently the virus that was in Arkham Asylum was Captain Boomerang, somehow connected to Zod. And thanks to Hack, he was brought back. And I guess DC ran out of ways to bring people back, so they literally just threw in. I mean, they had Dark Blackest Night. Now they just literally used a computer to bring Captain Boomerang back. Zod's taken out. Harley goes back to being crazy. We get introduced to... oh, God, why did her name leave me? Oh man, why did she leave me? Oh no, don't leave me. Killer Frost joining Suicide Squad. That's the backup story that's leading into the almighty Justice League versus Suicide Squad, which is coming, which came out the first part.
Wait, wasn't that the prelude this week to it?
Yes, that was the prelude. It was Killer Frost joining the Suicide Squad. Christine Armstrong, hello, how are you? Nice seeing you on here. You're a new name, that's for sure. How's it going, Christine? Happy holidays. Let's see. You guys ever read, we did that. Christine says, cool. It's great to have you on the show, by the way, Christine, and also Darth Vader, wherever you are. All new commenters, we love it. We love talking with you guys. Again, this is not Dark Avenger Live, where we usually do the back and forth more with comments, but we do it every Friday at 9:35 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Today it's just Dark Avenger comic book review, which is why we're literally going through all of our books from 2 weeks ago because it's late. And we had to cancel because earlier today we were very busy setting up for Christmas and whatnot over here. But we had the time tonight, late tonight, to do our comic review. And I said, you know what? We didn't do Dark Avenger Live. Let's do the comic review live. Man, the moment you beat that game and beat the game that got you through the holidays. So anyway, Flash. I am done with the Flash. I think I'm good for a while. As Jeremy mentioned in the comments, but for those of you that didn't, we'll talk about it. Thanks to Flash and Kid Flash, they're able to save Shade's girlfriend and Iris using literally a fist bump. And Shade does drop a bit of a hint to Barry about his wife. He's like, let your lovely wife get some rest, Flash. Give her my regards. And he's like, wife, I'm not married. And the book ends with basically Barry asking Iris out on a date. I might still read this book casually, digitally, but as far as a physical read, I think I'm good with the Flash at this point. I'm going to casually read it on the side. When things get better, yeah. My brother just called me today to let me know that there will be a new member in the Spider family. That's interesting. It's probably going to be Ben. Any games you guys are looking forward to in 2017? Spider-Man, more news on The Last of Us 2. Crash's remake. And Resident Evil. I keep hearing so many amazing things. For Honor. And to be discussed, I guess, because we're cutting down on getting so many games for obvious reasons. There is going to be an announcement on January 1st at 12 midnight.
What was the other game?
Sonic.
Yeah, Sonic, that's it.
And South Park.
Well, that's you.
I'm looking forward to Horizon Zero. I did take it off of our list. I got to wait and see what the reviews are for that game, and then I'll pick it up.
Yeah.
Oh, Larry said, wow. I won't say it out loud. I don't want to, but that's going to be very weird. That's right. There was. They did mention that, but I won't say it out loud just to be safe. But that's interesting.
Red Hood and the Outlaws, issue number 5. Black Mask is Black Mask, just like the Frontline Live.
Yeah, that was funny. Said. I'm sorry, but that was funny when you said he took his mask off to tell everybody he's Black Mask.
Well, I thought it was someone else, and he went by a different name. That's what they didn't make me finish. But Bizarre is unleashing all of his hatred and rage towards Jason Todd. While Black Mask is under his control, Artemis comes in to save him from all the killing and destruction of Bizarro. I love the artwork, by the way. I must say, in this comic book. And it's basically trying to get Bizarro on his side because that's the three of them. That's Red Hood, Artemis, and Bizarro. And Black Mask is just unleashing his hatred. And we get a little bit of his backstory, actually. Was it a backstory? Oh, I'm sorry. It was a little bit of Jason Todd's backstory. My mistake. And, it's just as Artemis tries to stop Bizarro while the cops are there. Yeah, it's just that Black Mask is just saying, he just takes off his mask. And I think the battle's going to be really heated on when it's Jason Todd versus Black Mask while Artemis is taking care of Bizarro. So this is like really something. I can't wait till the three teams come together because you know that's going to happen.
Oh, yeah.
Like that. But I'm looking forward to that. And I believe that's my final.
Last book.
Well, unless the other one is.
Oh, yeah. We can talk about that together. You read the Constantine one?
A little bit.
Good, because I didn't. Supergirl issue number 4. Man, I got to tell you guys, it was really a lot of just. I knew what this issue was going to be, and I still read it. The artwork definitely needs to be improved, but I hear there's a new artist coming in. You got Cyborg Superman attacking Earth. Kara tries to reach out to her mother and get her mother to realize, you know, that she's under Zor-El, a.k.a. Cyborg Superman's control. She finally does kind of reach out to her mother, or the humane, whatever humane side is left in her mother, and she's able to save Kara's Earth mother. And then, of course, Kara finds out that she could yell this, and it'll bug the computers out and it frees her. So now she's going back to Earth to fight Cyborg Superman, and her foster dad is now face to face with Cyborg Superman. And if that explanation did anything for you, let me know, because I read this book, I did this, I slid it back in its case, and I said, we didn't really get too much further away from. We need to get a lot more far away from what happened in the New 52 with Kara, because this. I'm sticking with Supergirl. I am, because I have a feeling things will get better. But there's a lot of. They show Cat Grant in here. It's just a lot of them trying to connect it with the New 52 Supergirl, the TV show. Don't worry, Christine. It was great having you on here. I have a son, too. I completely understand. If he wasn't asleep right now, I wouldn't be able to do this either. So take care. Hopefully we'll see you on another live show or through videos or whatever. Hopefully you subscribe and come back soon. And happy holiday to you and your family, especially a young one. That's the most important thing with the holiday seasons are the children. So let's see if anything. Speaking of Last of Us, remember the trailer, Logan? Did that remind you guys? A little bit, yeah, I did. It did. I can't wait for the new Assassin's Creed game. I can. I need a break a little bit.
What about the movie?
And I agree, Jeremy. Cyborg's been meh for me. I feel like they went right back to the New 52 with this story arc. When this story arc's over, if the following story arc is as weak as this, then I probably will be dropping Supergirl as well. I didn't even know you were still reading Supergirl and Mike reads Batgirl. I gave up on both of those around the first issue. Mike's enjoying Batgirl. I'm going to stick it out through the first story.
Let's see what happens now.
But Superwoman, however, Lana, they find out about Lana Luthor. Lana Luthor basically takes all the things that she believes is hers. And what happens is, what's her name? Natasha gets in the way of this takeover, this hostile takeover, trying to stop Lana. and she becomes like a bit of a casualty. I mean, they're able to save her, but Lana kind of super woman's out a bit and wants to save Natalia, but she's able to be saved. There's something that's dropped in this book, and I want to point this out to you. She's looking at all the people she has prisoner, and then she passes by Clark Kent, the Clark Kent that isn't Superman. And when she passes him, she's talking about all these people, a zealot, sociopath, looks at Clark. She goes, but you, Mr. Kent, you're something else. Yet another hint dropped about this mysterious Clark Kent. But anyway, Lana ends up having a bit of a seizure or something, and she has to get put back on a machine to recharge or whatever. But Lana ends up sneaking away from Steel, trying to fight off against the Supergirls, and let's just say this is how the book ends. Interesting, but I feel like the story's a little bit all over the place, and I feel like Lana's kind of, the character Lana is all over the place. She has Lois's ghost, she has Steel who's telling her she needs to chill because she's gonna die. She's too focused on dying, period. It's just, there's a lot of stuff going on, and it's a little bit crazy. Hannah, Blue Ridge makes her Marvel, making her Spider debut. Oh, wow. Interesting. I'll have to wait and see. We should call it The Last of Us, Logan. That'd be funny. Lana is speaking to New 52 Lois's Force Ghost. I like it. I do. But again, I feel like the story is just a little bit all over the place. It needs to get like a focal point. We didn't get to see Lex in this issue, which is good. We didn't have too many plot points. Batman just home runs every time everything goes on between him and Bane feels so well. That's next week. This week we got Detective Comics 946. Jeremy, you've been spot on, man. On all the books I've been picking up, and somebody else mentioned a book, and I picked up that book. But anyway, this book for Detective Comics though was a bit slow. I think this is the first time I really wasn't digging Detective as deeply. I mean, you got Batman, you have all of the Bat family facing off against one of the victim syndicate members. You've got Clayface facing off against the woman that he screwed. Batwoman and Batwing facing off against another two. You got, what's her name? Orphan facing off against another one. You've got Stephanie talking to a hollow program of Tim, and then she kind of comes to a realization that she needs to be there. She needs to save the world. She needs, oh, what was it? This isn't how the world's supposed to be, and I think I'm the only one left who can fix it. So I'm wondering, when she says that, remember, Mr. Oz took Tim off the playing field because he knew too much. I'm wondering if in that message or in that digital program that he left of himself for Stephanie, I'm wondering if she knows now what Tim found out or the pieces that Tim was starting to put together, and it leading me to wonder if at some point Mr. Oz is not going to be trying to get his hands on Stephanie. Very interesting. Again, though, the story just kind of fell short for me. I just wasn't feeling it as much as I was this week. Action Comics 969, I felt the same exact thing. I was not feeling it this week.
That's a shocker, actually.
Because this issue didn't have Superman in it. It had two pages of Superman. It had John watching on saying, Dad told me to stay here. Clark, the person that is Clark Kent, saying that Superman should let Lex Luthor rot. And then we get the backstory to the guy that's that brought Lex Luthor in. We get his backstory that he had a life of death. You know, he used to go and he used to kill people who were going to cause doom and gloom. He lost his family. He lost everything. He was ready to hang it up. And then his partner shows up and says, he talks about Lex Luthor's going to basically destroy all reality. Millions of people are going to die. And he's like, get me my helmet one more time. And Lex is still saying, you know, I didn't do anything. I'm not, you know, you're wrong that the SI wear stands for something completely different. I'd never be the next Dark Side. And then he says something that actually scares me. He's like, I'm not alone here. And then he whispers, there's a strong streak of good in you, Superman. You'll come for me. So he has faith that Superman is going to come for him. And that's exactly how the issue ends. This was a very Talking Heads issue. You get the villain's backstory that you really don't care about. The thing with Detective and Action Comics right now is they're putting in new supervillains that are going to be forgettable in like a year. A year from now, we're not going to be thinking about these guys that tried to assassinate or kill Lex Luthor because of a possible future. And we're not going to be thinking about the Victim Syndicate unless they continue to make, you know, points or show up in the Batman universe. So, the God Killer had a family. Exactly. It's like, I didn't care. It kind of slowed the story, the pace of the story down. Same thing with Detective Comics. This just seems like a really slow segue to the next story arc. Detective Comics just confused. Nothing really moved. No, nothing moved forward in Detective or Action. We got all backstory in Action, and in Detective, we just got, you know, a little bit of progression. Nightwing, I feel like I should make Court of Owls this main target. Well, read Nightwing now. He's back in Bloodhaven. It's really awesome. Hey, has there been any news about Sucker Punch? No, I didn't hear anything about that, man. Or better yet, make a new Batman NC go against Court of Owls. I don't know, man. Eagle's in the comments. What's going on, Eagle? Three more books left. Hopefully you'll be ready to do some stuff after that. But we got Green Lantern. Hal Jordan and the Green Lantern Corps. I like this issue so much. I can't explain. I cannot tell you guys how much I really enjoyed it. So Hal Jordan officially is dead for the moment. You got the Green Lantern and Yellow Lantern Corps who are now collected by Brainiac's robot and the Collector. They call in Kyle Rayner, the White Lantern, Gantha, and Sayed, call him in because they know he's the only one that can bring Hal back because there's still his life essence in the ring because he made the ring. So his life force is still connected to it, and there's a way to bring him back. And where Hal is he is in the, what is it called? The spectrum, the light spectrum. And it's where all honorable deaths, and you get to see all the lanterns that passed away in the past. This is where basically, it's kind of like think Dragon Ball Z, where when Goku died, he got to keep his body because he saved the world and he was selfless all of his life. This is where the Green Lanterns go when they pass on. And it's kind of like to honor, you know, that they served and that they died, you know, being Green Lanterns.
Wow.
And one thing I got to say is, Abin gives Hal a really strong message before they go back. I'm not going to get into all the talking, but he does tell Hal Jordan one thing before Hal goes back. And he says, the Green Lantern Corps, tell them, find hope. And I'm thinking with the connection of Gantha and Sayed and Abin saying find hope and the Blue Lanterns, there's literally only one Blue Lantern left. I have a feeling that Abin Sur sent Hal back with this message that Gantha and Sayed, they need to come out of hiding and they need to bring back the Blue Lantern Corps. And I hope this leads to DC maybe making a miniseries for the Blue Lantern Corps at least. I'd love it. And then we find out that the Collector is not Brainiac, but it's freaking Larfleeze. And the next story arc begins next issue. We still don't know if Sinestro survived that explosion or not, but we know now, thanks to Kyle, Hal is back. And now he has to go save the Green Lantern Corps from Larfleeze. And it's really interesting. I'm really looking forward to seeing what happens next. And I'm hoping it brings the Blue Lantern Corps back. Thank you. Did you guys ever read Outsiders? No, I did not. I did not, but I should have. Can't stand Hal at this point. He's like a young John Cena. No, he isn't. No, DN. No, he isn't.
Ooh, like a what?
Like a John Cena. This is Robert at his finest. DC should make a deal with him and let him develop their comic. Maybe. But we got Wonder Woman issue 12. This is the last one that's all me. And it's back to year one. Wonder Woman is basically stretching out, trying to figure out all of her abilities. We find out that Wonder Woman actually had a girlfriend that she left behind when she chose to come to the world of man. We find out also that Barbara Ann might actually also be interested in women in this issue. But now I got to say, this book does it organically. It's not forced. It's not thrown at you like, oh my God, she is a lesbian. Or, oh my God, Wonder Woman was a lesbian before she came to the world of men. It's just touched on and then moved on. I got to give Greg Rucka a huge pat on the back because he literally does not make that the focal point of the book, unlike certain other people whose names won't be mentioned, Brian Michael Bendis, who literally are focusing on making a character that way and then literally spotlighting it in almost every issue and then making a solo series specifically to get into it more.
The same.
Mm-hmm. So we do get a little bit of a nice moment with her and Steve, which I like that. I like that a lot also. But they get into the research of that tattoo. Wonder Woman mentions a bit about the tattoo, about what she knows about the tattoo. She uses her lasso on the people who went, who were the, oh God, who they were the terrorists that were shooting up the mall. And it turns out that they really weren't of sound mind, that it was kind of like a virus. And they're wondering what the cause was. And well, if you looked at the cover, there's only one person who could be the cause. Enter Ares. To be concluded. Next to Truth Part 1. Then back here for Year 1 Conclusion. Yeah. Year 1 is the Truth series. The Truth Part 1 is happening in Wonder Woman's next issue. And then this Year 1 story arc will be over next month. And that means Wonder Woman then will be on a one story arc unless they separate it again and go to like Year 1.5 or something. I haven't looked at the solicits yet. But I believe that Wonder Woman's probably just going to be the one story arc. Now, disclaimer, before we talk about our last book, which is
The Holly Special, issue number 1, DC Rebirth.
Yes.
Holly Special.
Before we get into the DC Comics Holiday Special, I want you to take a look at the price tag. The price tag is $9.99. And while we are going to probably say a lot of great things about this book, we did not pay that price for this book. We got this book on DCBS on, I believe, about 40% off. So we only ended up paying about maybe $5, which is how much an annual should be. I think DC and Marvel are starting to lose it a bit when it comes to their annuals. DC, this is the first time DC's done it. Marvel's done it multiple times, and they're doing it again, as Larry mentioned and as Jeremy mentioned and a few other people mentioned, with Amazing Spider-Man 25. We do not need to pay $10 for books like this. And a lot of people won't, and I don't understand why they continue to do it. Maybe because the people like us that get it discounted still buy it, and I guess it counts. But never pay $10 for a book this thin. This, back in the 90s and the early 2000s, the mid-2000s even, was $5, not $10. This is not worth $10, regardless how good it is. And I will say, I love the two Superman stories in here. There was a John Kent story at the beginning with Damian.
No, it was Harley Quinn.
No, Harley Quinn is the segue between the stories. But the first official story, which is called The Last Minute, Clark and Bruce both are chasing after the same action figure for their sons. And I got to say, the artwork is freaking gorgeous. And Superman literally is flying all over the United States to try to find this figure for his son. He finally finds one, and Damian Wayne comes in and basically yoinks it. Yes, Damian Wayne. They actually do meet in this issue. For $9.99, you can get over 4,000 hours of wrestling on the WWE. That's right. This book costs the WWE Network.
Plus $2 extra.
Right. Now, Damian ends up with the figure. Apparently, Bruce comes over for Christmas dinner. I thought this was a very warm story, and I'm glad that Bruce and Clark are getting very close like they were in the old DC Universe. But we find out that Damian bought the figure, not for himself. As much as he wanted it for himself, he bought it for John. And I love John's reaction. And I guess they're really working on building John and Damian's relationship. And it's great. I think it's going to be really great for Super Sons. And this, again, is a really great teaser for what's to come in Super Sons next year. the next story arc is about crypto. And John kind of is questioning, you know, does he know that he's really not, you know, a human dog, that he's really Kryptonian, he's something different. I love the showcase of the old costume, the Lois and Clark costume and the Sun costume, which is kind of paying homage way back when. But in the end, they get Crypto a really cool yellow dog collar. And I thought that was cool. The next story arc I kind of skipped around because it was Detective Chimp and Batman. And I really wasn't keen on the artwork. I really wasn't into it. So I skipped that. And then we go into Michael's story, which is with John Constantine and Wonder Woman.
Yeah, so with John Constantine and Wonder Woman in the story, we all know that not many people are a big fan of John Constantine. So what he does is his ritual of magic and stuff.
Oh, Comicology has this book on sale. I'm just going to say that out loud. And DC and Marvel Comics for the holidays. Okay, so that's good.
And I wanted to show some artwork, which is a little bit okay for the John Constantine story.
Please stop banning the book.
Well, I'm trying to show the artwork. So like I said, his magic rituals, you know, are causing spirits to come back to life. And, yeah, and then it gets to your story about Flash.
Flash, I looked at it minorly. I was not really a fan of the artwork. It was a very short story, a couple of pages. And then I think we went into... we went into New Superman. That was an interesting story. I kind of got a little bored with it, but it was only like one page. And then we went into a bunch of short stories.
Batwoman, Lion of the Dark.
Batwoman story, I love the artwork, and the story was really good on that too. But again, we were getting close to the end of the book, and my attention span, so many stories, plus all the other comics I had to read. You know, you start skimming the stories a bit. But I like the Batwoman story from what I saw. This story was Nightwing. Nightwing's story was really good. It's the Titans. It was this Titan story where it's the holiday night and they're out fighting crime. Kid Flash isn't there. I'm wondering if Wally's going to quit the Titans after the first story arc, which would suck. But then there's a Simon Boz and Jessica Cruz story where they kind of go back to where they were before they got their rings. And Jessica and Simon kind of are not exactly too okay with that. But they end up breaking free of it. They have a really nice talk. And then in the end, we go to Harley, who's having a Christmas party with all of the rest of the Justice League. I thought it was a nice issue, but again, I got to say, and it ends with, of course, Amanda Waller Suicide Squad, and it's St. Patrick's Day. It was hilarious, but again, for $10, no. Even for the John Kent story, the Crypto story, the Batwoman story, which was good, the Titan story, which was good, do not pay $10 for this book. It was good, but don't pay $10. If you can get it on sale, like MT said, if you can find it somewhere where it is not $10, $5 maximum, then definitely buy it. But do not pay $10. Guys, it is us who buy the books. It is the readers that tell the comic companies it's okay or not okay when it comes to prices and stories. And in this case, if we continue to buy books that are $10 for $10, Marvel and DC are going to continue to make $10 books. For that $10, you add two more dollars and you can get a trade paperback. No joke, a trade paperback with 4 to 5 comics in it. Birthright Volume 1 was $10. For one penny more, you could get the Birthright trade paperback, the first 5 comics, for that exact price. Now, I know DC, this is the first time they're doing it, you know, little slap on the wrist and don't do it again. Marvel has been doing it more and more and more. Marvel did it first. The first time we saw something like that was Deadpool's wedding. Second time we saw that was Deadpool's, there was an issue later on. I forgot what it was. And then the third time we saw it was in another book. I forgot what that was. And now we're seeing it again with Amazing Spider-Man 25.
That's something.
This is where we got to start telling Marvel, no, $10 is not what we are willing to spend for books that are that thick. Because that is a $5 book. And they're charging you more they add like five more pages and they think they have the right to add another $5. And I don't agree with that. And you guys should not pay $10 for books. Unfortunately, DC's getting the brunt of this little rant because it's their book that we're talking about. But Marvel's done it way more often, too often, I would say, way too often. One Deadpool book was enough. Two Deadpool books was really pushing it. Whatever the third book was that left my mind was bad, and now with Amazing Spider-Man, this is the worst. And this needs to stop. And the only way we can do that is to send a message to Marvel by not buying it. Let's see. Do you think if pre-Flashpoint Batman came into the universe, he would be super jealous of how... No, I don't think he'd be jealous because it would be him. You guys ever play Kingdom Hearts? Yes. You didn't miss much. I was talking about the $10. I hate to say it. I will, since I'm a huge Amazing Spider-Man fan, Chris. Okay, so say it. I don't know what you said. I'm waiting for 2 points. Okay, we're talking about games. I want to stick with the comic books. But but anyway, I don't think it's worth the $10. But anyway, that is this week's comic review as we wait for Larry to say what he hates to say, and then we are going to head off. But thank you guys for sticking with us live. If you'd like to stick around more live, if I am going to go back on, I know I shouldn't plug this at the end of a comic review of all things, but go, if you're subscribed to Frontline Gaming Zone, or if you're not, go over to Frontline Gaming Zone and subscribe. I might live stream a little bit on the PlayStation after this live show. If you guys are interested, if Eagle's going back on and if we're going to play some Division, definitely I will pay for the Amazing. See, that's the problem, Larry. People are willing to pay the $10 for Amazing Spider-Man 25, and that means Marvel will think about doing it again somewhere else. And it needs to stop. That's what, and you know, I love Spider-Man 2, and man, I'm getting 25, but I'm getting it at a discount. You know, I'm making sure to pre-order it at DCBS or somewhere. Midtown is 15%, DCBS is no less than 35%. I would not pay 100% for that comic, not $100. Not worth it. Not now, not 10 years from now, and not 10 years not 10 years back from now, and not 10 years forward from now. But anyway, if you guys like to check out more, like I said, Frontline Gaming Zone. We are Comic Frontline, though. We are your number one source for comic-related news, reviews, and a whole bunch more. If you like what you see here and you're not subscribed, hopefully you will smash that subscribe button. This way we will be in your sub box, and you will not miss out on a single video, live show, or any other post we do on here. We have videos daily, or we try to during the holiday season. It's a bit harder to do that. There's Frontline Gaming Zone, as I mentioned, which is our gaming channel. There is an announcement coming on January 1st that's going to expand us even further. And also, you can check out all of our individual channels on the main Comic Frontline channel. All of our channels are listed there. And if you want more Frontline goodness, go over to comicfrontline.com for even more Frontline goodness. Once again, everybody, happy holidays. Have a wonderful Christmas, Hanukkah, Kwanzaa, or if you don't celebrate any of them, a wonderful winter solstice or winter break. Well,
winter solstice was already first day of winter.
Well, they might make a holiday up or whatever, or if they don't celebrate any of those holidays, or they might just be celebrating winter break. Either way, whatever you celebrate, happy holidays, Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, Happy Kwanzaa, and we will see you guys back here again, yep, probably right before New Year's, where we'll be wishing you guys a Happy New Year's. But till then, happy holidays. We hope you get everything you want, whatever holiday you celebrate. And if you don't celebrate a holiday, go out and buy yourself something really great because you deserve it. You guys are amazing. Thank you, guys. I only buy comics on Midtown Comics now. All right, Larry, but that's still a good discount. They still do good discounts. So thank you guys so much for being here. And we will see you guys really soon in the next video. Love you guys. Happy holidays. Take care and have a great night.
Bye, everybody.